Because they never took the Arabs seriously as actors. They condescend tremendously to them. So Arab support for Israel would be seen as some kind of false contrast. They don't really care about the Arabs.
Hello, I'm Jonathan Tobin, editor-in-chief of the Jewish News Syndicate, JNS.org. And you're listening to Top Story, a weekly podcast where I analyze the most important stories happening in Jewish news around the world. Each week, I will break down politics, foreign policy, and culture to provide insights into what is going on behind the headlines. Hello, and welcome to Top Story. One of the standard tropes of criticism of Israel is the notion that it is constantly violating international law. But what is international law, really? Is it something that is based on universal principles that all decent people respect? Or is it merely what the international community, or more specifically, what the United Nations and its agencies say it is, regardless of actual law? Are these supposedly widely accepted concepts actually devoid of merit and largely motivated by anti-Semitic sentiments that lead the UN to not only devote disproportional attention to disputes involving Israel, but also to single it out to be judged by double standards and for unfair condemnations? In every key dispute involving Israel, whether it is Jerusalem or the settlements, the problem always winds up being rooted in distorted ideas about what is legal or illegal, and by whose standards is that judgment being rendered. For those seeking to understand these issues, it's necessary to go back, not just to history, but to an understanding of what is really meant by rights and law. If we do, it's easy to see that many current controversies would have to be seen in a very different light. At the top of the agenda recently is what may seem like a minor issue to some, the question of whether the United States should reopen a consulate in Jerusalem that serves the Palestinian Authority, even though it is located on sovereign Israeli soil. Another is what is really going on in a property dispute involving land and homes owned by Jews but occupied illegally by Palestinian Arabs, and whether the United States and the international community was right to seek to pressure Israel and its court system to rule in favor of the squatters and not the Jewish property owners. Is it really illegal for Jews to build in those parts of Jerusalem that were in Arab hands before 1967? Is that also true about communities in the West Bank, where the international press, as well as the UN, takes it for granted that the Jewish presence is somehow illegal? To discuss all of these issues, we're pleased to have with us someone today who has devoted himself to the study of the application of law to the conflict in the Middle East. Eugene Kontorovich is the professor of law and director of the Center for the Middle East and International Law at the Antonin Scalia Law School of George Mason University, as well as one of the world's preeminent experts on universal jurisdiction and maritime piracy, as well as international law and the Israeli-Arab conflict. Eugene Kontorovich, welcome to Top Story.
Thank you. Great to be here with you.
Thanks for coming on. Eugene, let's start by defining the ideas that we're talking about. When people reference international law when discussing Israel, what are they actually talking about? And how different is that from any coherent concept of law and rights that's worth respecting?
So that's a big question. When I teach international law in law school, we spend about the first 3 weeks talking about what is international law. And that itself is a bit of an elusive concept. Because international law, unlike domestic law, does not emanate from a central decision maker with coercive power, like, let's say, Congress and the president. So it's a much more amorphous thing. And it consists principally of treaties and customary rules. When people talk about international law as it applies to Israel, they are usually not talking about conventional international law. Rather, they're talking about the political decisions of often the United Nations bodies, which are not binding and are not sources of international law, or so-called rules of law, which are said to apply in the case of Israel, but it is hard to find them existing or having any application in any other context. So they're what I would call rules for one country only, which is the opposite of international law.
So why has the whole concept of international law seemingly been mobilized, as you say, in this political version, to delegitimize the rights of Israel and Jews when it comes to Jerusalem and the territories?
So the question is, why do it through international law? And I think you touch on an important point. When you hear other conflicts, other geopolitical conflicts, other territorial disputes discussed, Turkey and Northern Cyprus, Russia and Donbass, Morocco and Western Sahara. Now, you're not going to hear those discussed half as often as you hear Israel discussed, but they are typically discussed without any legal verbiage. So I've read many articles from European newspapers about Northern Cyprus conflict, and they don't use legal words like occupation or illegal. These are all legal words. But in discussions of the Israel-Arab conflict, it is inevitably coupled with legal terminology like occupied. It's a legal term, illegally occupied. So the question is, why is that? So I'm not a social psychologist. I can't answer for sure. But I might speculate a few reasons. First of all, international law is an obscure and abstruse field. Even most lawyers don't know much about it. And given that most people don't really care about international law, except when it comes to a way of talking about Israel, it won't be worth it for most people to go and find out. So it is a way of making claims couched in a language of technocratic expertise that are hard for most people to evaluate. So someone says it's illegal under international law, it's difficult for most people to go and say, well, is that how we treat Western Sahara? Is that how we treat Northern Cyprus? Is that how we treat Berlin or many other contexts? So it's a way of making, of lifting a political issue and attempting to put it in a realm of expertise from which most people will be excluded. That's one reason, potentially. I'm speculating. Another reason is law is a way people come to so certain kinds of mid-level agreements about how to behave. Law is a way to coordinate the actions of people who might have fundamental normative disagreements, but they agree to abide by the rules of the road, shall we say. That's particularly true of international law, right? So international law is supposed to be law that governs all the countries in the world. Now, rules of international law have to be accepted by all the countries of the world, which means they're going to be very thin, minimalistic rules of basic rules of the road for international cooperation, because obviously countries in the world don't agree on pretty much anything, right? Communism, capitalism, freedom, not freedom, Christianity, Islam, right? There's massive disagreement. So they're not going to agree on the big values. So it's but they need to get along. So it's a kind of mid-level agreement for those with normative disagreements. So an appeal to law could be rhetorically effective when it's impossible to appeal directly to moral intuitions or sort of prior beliefs. So in other words, let's say you want to convince someone who believes that Jews come from Judea and that Jerusalem has been the capital of Israel, of the Jewish people, from time immemorial, that the Jews' holiest sites, the Jews should not be able to live there. Right? It may be difficult to do that as a moral matter, right? Especially because we live in a... So let me give you an example. This is a legal statement. The legal statement is Israeli civilians are not allowed to transfer themselves or live in places that fell under Israeli control as a result of the 1967 conflict or the use of armed force by Israel in that conflict because of the Geneva Conventions. That's a legal claim. And another claim would be the areas from which Jordan ethnically cleansed Jews and kept Judenrein between 1948 and 1967, should permanently be Judenrein, and if they ever come under Jewish control, Israeli control, Israel should take efforts, great efforts, maximum efforts, to ensure that no Jew should be enabled to live there indefinitely. Okay, the second statement sounds very illiberal and maybe repugnant to sort of modern liberal values, that there should be a place in the world, forget any place, let alone some place with a historic Jewish connection, that Jews are, because of being Jewish, are forbidden to live, let alone that that should be enforced by Israel. Those two statements are factually identical. That is to say, they describe the same idea, right? That Jews should not live across the armistice line, 1948 armistice line with Jordan. Mm. But one of them sounds normative and nice, even, right? Part of a world order. The other sounds reactionary and anti-Semitic. So you don't want to say, you know, it's a war crime for Jews to pray at their holiest site, or Jews should not be forbidden from living in the Jewish quarter of Jerusalem, and Israel must enforce this. That sounds racist. But to say international law prohibits settlements in occupied territory, already you've used a whole bunch of words nobody understands, and you have made something horrible sound nice. So I think it's important to translate this into layman's terms. There is a claim that there's a part of the world where Jews should not be allowed to live because of Jordan's expulsion of Jews from those areas from 1949. That is to say, in the legal argument against Israel, had Jordan not expelled the Jews in 1949 and taken control of that territory, there'd be no problem with Jews living there. So the international law here seeks to make permanent Jordan's ethnic cleansing. And that's quite a thing.
Yeah, especially since the document that applied to the area before then, the mandate for Palestine, specifically gave the right of Jews to settle in all those lands, didn't it?
Yeah, exactly. And the Mandate of Palestine is an internationally legally binding document because it was adopted by the League of Nations, which by its charter was given power by the nations of the world to make mandates, make trust territories to turn former Ottoman and German colonies into independent nation states. And the word settlements, very interesting, the word settlements is not a legal term. The word settlements does not appear in the Geneva Convention. It does not appear in any international treaty. So the word settlements is used. It's a colloquial word, and it's interesting. We can talk about why it's used. But the only time the word settlement is used, actually, in anything to do with Israel, is the League of Nations mandate, which says, which gives Jews the right to settle in the land of Israel, including what's now called the West Bank and was then just called Palestine.
Right. Let's focus on the dispute between Israel and the United States over diplomatic representation in Jerusalem. We know that the staff of the Biden administration, almost all Obama administration alumni, believe that the Trump administration's decision to recognize Jerusalem as the capital of Israel was wrong, but don't think it's worth expending the political capital to reverse it. But they do wish to undermine it with opening a consulate to the Palestinians. What would be the implications and the consequences if, despite the clear opposition of the Israeli government, that consulate is reopened? And I guess the follow-up is, can Israel stop it if it wants to?
So, yeah, let me start from the back. The United States has recognized Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. This was a policy that was first articulated by Congress in the 1990s. It was completely bipartisan. It was finally adopted by the Trump administration, finally implemented by the Trump administration. And it was not particularly controversial. That is to say, there were many on the Democratic side of the aisle who said it shouldn't be done, but they mentioned purely prudential reasons, mostly for that it would alienate the Arab world, it would result in mass violence, set the Middle East on fire. So those things have not happened. And so now it seems it's the recognition is quite stable and the Biden administration has not talked about reversing it. At the same time, it's quite clear that there are people in the progressive camp that the Biden administration wishes to appeal to who very much would like to see this undone. So the consulate is indeed a way, the idea of a consulate to the Palestinians in Jerusalem is a way of partially undoing it. But let me say that under international law, there is a treaty about consulates. Consulates and diplomatic representation are the kind of things which there's a lot of international law about, unlike many other issues. And the treaty on international relations says very simply that you cannot open a consulate or similar mission in another country's territory without that country's permission. So Israel would have to give a variety of permissions to the United States. So Israel is not giving those permissions, and that is why the United States is not opening the consulate. They cannot do so without Israel's consent. Now, they may attempt to coerce Israel's consent, and they have done so to bully Israel into agreeing, but the Israeli government has thus far been very steadfast on this issue, because I think this is what the American administration did not understand. The sovereignty over an undivided Jerusalem, Israeli sovereignty over Jerusalem, is not a partisan issue in Israel. It's not clear who they speak to in Israel, but who they speak to don't seem, I think, are not representative of Israeli politics. Well, certainly everyone from Yair Lapid to the right, and maybe even everyone from somewhere in the middle of the Labour Party to the right, favor Israeli sovereignty over Jerusalem. And the whole point of the consulate is to call that into question. Because you open a consulate in another country's territory. So to open a consulate in Jerusalem to the Palestinians is specifically to recognize Palestinian claims to Jerusalem. And it's not me saying this, right? It's not me saying this. It's the left-leaning Israel Policy Forum says that's the reason to have a consulate in Jerusalem, to recognize that the Palestinians have claims. Dan Shapiro said, a consulate, former ambassador to the United States, the consulate in Jerusalem recognizes Palestinian claims to the city. So while it does not divide Jerusalem, it certainly sets the stage. Because if you want to have relations with the Palestinians, and if you want to meet with the Palestinians and schmooze with the Palestinians, which is what the Americans say they want to do, they say the Palestinian Mahmoud Abbas is uncomfortable schmoozing with America, with American diplomats in the American embassy in Jerusalem, because Abbas does not like that the American embassy is in Jerusalem. Okay, so they want to schmooze with them nonetheless. They can open a diplomatic mission in Ramallah, which is the seat of the Palestinian government. That's where Abbas has his office. It's where the Palestinian National Council sits. And indeed, most European countries and countries for Arab countries and many other countries, dozens of countries, have their representation to the Palestinians in Ramallah. That's the place where it makes sense to do so. To not do it in Ramallah is to say we are recognizing some kind of Palestinian claim to Jerusalem. But it gets worse. It gets worse. The way that this consulate would work, is the consul general would not report to the ambassador. The consul general would not report to the ambassador. So you'd have a consulate like a mile away from the embassy, and the consul general would not report to the ambassador. Now, in standard international practice, this is like the rule everywhere, certainly US practice everywhere, the ambassador is the top official in the country, and all the other officials of that country, wherever they are, have to answer to the ambassador. So all the consuls would be subordinate normally to the ambassador. To have a consul who's not subordinate to in Jerusalem, who's not subordinate to the ambassador, is to suggest that maybe, why is he not subordinate, right? Because it's to suggest that Jerusalem is not really part of Israel. Because if it were part of Israel, under standard American practice, he would have to report to the ambassador. So the purpose of this is quite clear. There's a reason why this was the number one Israel policy priority of Representative Ilhan Omar. And it's because it's a big deal. It's not a small thing. It's not a technical thing. It's not just about a convenient place to have coffee with a boss. Right? It's about seeking to partially undo the recognition of Jerusalem without paying the political price of doing so openly, as you said.
Now, I guess the sort of the technical question here is that you've outlined the law very clearly, and in terms of international agreements, the United States cannot do it without Israel's say-so. But they own the building, and people, technically they can have people working in there without sort of Israel's permission. And can they just do it by subterfuge rather than even without obtaining permission?
Well, formalities matter here. So it doesn't matter if there's people working in the building. That's fine. It's their building. They can do whatever they want. It's not the building. It's its status as a diplomatic mission, as a consulate, right? So you're going to have an office building. You're going to have people, but it doesn't have diplomatic status. So that is relevant to questions of immunity, extraterritoriality, many legal questions. So it can be a building, but it can't be a diplomatic mission. And in terms of things they do, the Vienna Convention is also quite clear that consular functions are what make a consulate. They cannot perform consular functions there, which includes diplomatic representation to the Palestinian Authority. It would be a violation of international law. I don't think the Americans are going to violate international law and break the Vienna Convention on consular relations. For the sake of this, it seems the current strategy of the State Department is to slow down this issue, take it off the front burner, and potentially wait for a more politically fortuitous, because they see the Israeli government is truly united against them. So they may wait to a more politically fortuitous moment. For example, they may think that when Yair Lapid rotates into the prime ministry, that may be a more politically fortuitous movement. Or after the United States midterms might be a more politically convenient moment. So the issue is not over, but they may have slowed it down, seeing that it's going to be far more difficult to achieve than they expected, and thus to wait for an auspicious time.
Yeah. It also leads me to wonder whether, because they're in the middle of an attempt to appease Iran, which is obviously an existential question for Israel, whether they want to fight the Israelis on two diplomatic fronts rather than just one at a time. By putting Jerusalem on sort of the back burner for the moment, is that an ominous sign about what's going on with Iran?
No, because I think the scale of these issues is so different. The Jerusalem consulate is like it's an important issue, but in the scheme of the world, it's not such an important issue. And no one's going to have a war about it. Iran is about the security of the entire Middle East, Southern Europe, and beyond. A nuclear Iran will have implications around the world. It's a big deal to the whole world. And, the stakes and the options include use of force, war in the Middle East. So whatever America would do on that, it would do independent and regardless of its Jerusalem policy. And also, the Biden administration does not seem to have a problem of fighting with Israel on numerous fronts. They're insisting for a complete settlement freeze of the kind that even President Obama did not ask for and did not get. It's quite clear that they are seeking to multiply diplomatic conflicts rather than reduce them. But this is just something where they don't need Israel's agreement to make a deal with Iran. They don't need Israel's agreement to insist on a settlement, though they do need it to get one. They don't need Israel's agreement to bash Israel over so-called settler violence. But they do need Israel's agreement to open a consulate.
Mm-hmm. Let's switch to the property dispute in the neighborhood of Sheikh Jarrah in Jerusalem that was supposedly the cause of the fighting in May between Israel and Hamas in Gaza. Is there really any doubt about who's in the right as far as the law is concerned? And why is so much of the world, including the United States government, so eager to invalidate what seems to be the rights of the property owners of these homes?
It's quite clear. So the Sheikh Jarrah issue is quite clear. It is not significantly disputed that the property belongs to Jews. This is a property that it was in the parts of Jerusalem. It's in Jerusalem, near the Old City. And it was seized by Jordan in 1948. The Jews had to run away, and their property was seized by Jordan. Jordan let some Palestinian Arabs squat in these properties. these Jewish-owned properties. In 1967, Israel retakes control, and after some period, the successors and interests of the Jewish owners begin proceedings to recover the property. So there are these families there who have been squatting there literally for 50 years without paying rent. And this is the longest fight for possession ever. This is like Jaundice versus Jaundice. It's some kind of Dickensian odyssey. And finally, after 50 years of law, 40 years of lawsuits, there's some prospect that the owners will be allowed to take possession of the building. Still a great deal for the Palestinians, who managed to live rent-free in the middle of Jerusalem for decades, and they're not going to have to pay back rent. So let me say, property disputes in Jerusalem are commonplace. If the owner of the property were Arabs seeking to recover property from other Arabs who were wrongfully possessing it, which happens all the time also, this would be a routine case in Israeli court. Israeli court routinely evicts Arabs at the behest of other Arabs who own the property. The only reason for controversy is that the owners of the property are Jews. This campaign has been really instigated and egged on by far-left groups like Peace Now. And when you read what they say about it, it's very interesting. They make many claims trying to cast doubt on the owner's rights, but fundamentally they say, even if they do own it, it doesn't matter. Jews should not be able to live there. So it has become, and this is one of the more distressing things about it, it has become a mainstream position that Jews should not be able to exercise property rights. Now, the converse position, imagine if there was a Jewish neighborhood and there was a huge campaign to keep Arabs from moving in because it would be bad for peace. Arabs move into Jewish neighborhoods throughout Jerusalem all the time. Arab citizens, Jerusalem Arabs with Israeli residents. No one thinks that that blocks the peace process. So it is really has the notion that Jews should be barred from living certain places where Jews have historically lived. Simply because the Jordanians kicked them out, is extraordinary and repugnant.
Yeah. Now, the interesting twist on this story is that the Arab squatters refused a compromise that would have allowed them to stay where they are at minimal cost. And I think this kind of shows that the dispute is sort of the entire Israeli-Arab-Palestinian conflict in miniature. With Arabs acting against their own interests, even to the point of causing themselves real suffering, merely in order to bolster the Palestinian national cause, which is unfortunately inextricably tied to their century-long war against Zionism. By refusing this compromise, it's sort of everything in a nutshell, isn't it?
So this is before the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court badly does not want to issue an eviction order, because it is afraid of the diplomatic and...
the Israeli Supreme Court, just to be clear.
Storm that will erupt. They're really not, so generally left-wing court. So it really says a lot that this left-wing court is poised to issue this eviction order. They just don't see a legal way out. So they said, here, listen, why don't we make a deal? If the Arabs recognize, that the Jewish owners are owners and pay them a minimal sort of nominal rent, they can stay there for the next 15 years. Basically, essentially rent-free. And some of them will be able to stay even longer. Now, the interesting twist is, after some thinking, most of the families, as I understand, did accept the deal. And they were about to notify the court, or they did notify in some cases the court, that they were accepting the deal. They were immediately besieged by Palestinian political factions, by Hamas, the PLO, and they were bullied and threatened and intimidated into not agreeing to the compromise because the political goal of the PLO and Hamas is to prevent Jews from living anywhere in these places, to have Jew-free zones. And it's very sad that the United States and so-called human rights groups are on exactly the same page with this political goal. I should add that in Israel, Jews can buy land from Arabs can buy land from Jews. The Palestinian Authority has a death penalty for Palestinians who sell land to Jews. Now, this is not land that was sold to Jews. This is land the Jews already. So it comes out that Jews can't buy land, and Jews can't even use land that they already own. So I don't know. That's beginning to sound like apartheid to me.
Well, exactly. And upholding that is clearly, a priority. And yet the international community, in the name supposedly of international law, in contradiction of any normal concept of law, is willing to uphold it, isn't it?
The United States, it was particularly shocking, is the United States involvement, because the United States recognizes Jerusalem as part of Israel. So if Jerusalem is part of Israel, why shouldn't Jews be able to live in houses owned by Jews in Israel? That's shocking. So forget that Jews can't live in houses owned by Jews in Arab countries. That Jews can't meaningfully live, safely live in houses that they've owned in Cairo or Lebanon or Damascus. We're going to extend the Damascus principle to Jerusalem.
Let's broaden our lens a little bit, and let's turn to the question of West Bank settlements. Is the argument over Jewish building in Judea Samaria fundamentally any different from that of building in Jerusalem? And why is it that so many Jews think that this distinction, which is actually not recognized by Israel's foes or its international critics, that they think that this can be maintained, that somehow Jerusalem is separate and the West Bank is treif, as it were?
Right. So it's important to say that from the point of view of the United States, there should be a distinction. So the United States recognizes Jerusalem as part of Israel. So they should not care about building in places like the Atarot Airport, where no Palestinian families live, where no one's being evicted. It's a former airport, British airport, that later run by the Jordanians. So it's a runway. So why should Jews not live on? Why should Israel have to build housing units by knocking down a forest rather than building up on a runway to expand housing in Jerusalem? But the United States opposes even that. So for the United States, even though they say Jerusalem's Israel, they are treating Israel the way they're treating the West Bank, which means this is not really a legal question.
No, I'm just saying that is the question of Jewish rights in the West Bank. Now it's clear the United States recognizes Jerusalem now, or at least West Jerusalem. That's not clear as part of Israel.
It recognizes Jerusalem as part of Israel. Yeah, now, if you think that there is a difference between Jerusalem, groups like the Europeans don't recognize a difference. The Europeans think Jews should not be able to live anywhere. Their definition of where Jews should not be able to live is those areas occupied by Jordan in 1948. So that's the amazing
thing. Yeah, I might add Jordan illegally occupied, too.
Illegally annexed and taken over. The Jordan attack in Egypt attacked Israel in the war in 1948 with the goal of preventing the creation of a Jewish state. So they were partially unsuccessful, witness Israeli independence. But they were partially successful in occupied territory. The current position of groups like Peace Now is that those areas from which Jordan managed to take over with the goal of preventing a Jewish state should forever be forbidden from Jews from living in. And that's a shocking position. Now, there's no good reason to not allow Jews to live in the West Bank either.
That's what I'm getting at, because the legality of the Jewish presence there.
So it's a big discussion, but in short, if you look around the world, there's not a single territory in the world, a single disputed territory, where the international community says some group is not allowed to live. No one has ever been excluded from territory. Now, in the case of the West Bank, I do not believe there's a condition of occupation. Israel has made peace with Jordan in 1994. So, famously, the State Department legal advisor wrote a memo in 1978, which he concluded that the West Bank is occupied, certain restrictions apply. He also said in that memo that if Israel ever makes peace with Jordan, that would be the end of the occupation, and there would be no problem with settlements. So Israel made peace with Jordan almost 30 years ago. So there can no longer, 1994, there can no longer be any thought that there is an occupation, because an occupation occurs in wartime and there is no international armed conflict in the area. So this is really a way of trying to use law, to legal terminology, to make an area permanently Judenrein. And there is not a single place where the international community complains about illegal settlers, though there are many occupied territories in the world, many disputed territories, lots of population migration in these places. So when you look, this really seems to be a rule made up uniquely for Israel.
But yet, it has attained almost the status of an international consensus. It's almost impossible to find a reference to the presence of Jewish communities in Judea and Samaria, the West Bank, a nonsensical geographical term that was only introduced because from 1948 to 1967 Jordan had two banks, the West and the East. No longer makes any sense now, but it has become sort of the term of art. And yet, no one questions this outside of, half of Israel or a majority of Israel. But so therefore it has, sort of attained this sort of, sanctity that is somehow unquestioned.
So importantly, it has been significantly questioned, and in particular, it's been questioned by the most important country in the world, the United States. And the United States has adopted the position that these Jewish communities are not illegal. So the United States position...
Under the Trump administration.
It was adopted. Well, it's complicated. The Trump administration formally elaborated this position, but I would argue that it has been United States policy for at least 40 years since Ronald Reagan in 1981 or 1982 said that settlements are not illegal, and that position was never reversed. And if you listen carefully to President Obama's statements on the issue, he always said that settlements are illegitimate, which means things we don't like but are not illegal. He was very careful not to call them illegal. So it has not been the U.S.
position that settlements are illegal since...
Yeah, it's not been the U.S. position that settlements are illegal since the Carter administration. And now the U.S. position is that they are, in fact, legal. That is not a position that the Biden administration has changed. So that's very important. And when I used to make my legal arguments for why these communities are not illegal, legal, people would say, oh, but the problem is all the countries disagree with you, so too late. It's a bit of a circular argument, because you can't ever change things if you go by what everyone agrees to. But now it's just not the case. It's not the case. There's a significant disagreement. Also, we know that it's not the case that all the countries actually agree with this. There was a moment about 5-6 years ago when Australia, having studied the issue, the Australian Justice Minister wanted to start referring to Jerusalem not as occupied territory, but as disputed territory. This triggered such a storm of boycott and economic sanctions threats, and worse, from Arab countries that they had to back down. Now, does that mean that they actually don't think it's disputed as opposed to occupied? Or does it mean they're just afraid to say it, right? So I think opinion is actually much more divided, but everyone is afraid to take a stand. And you see that when a country begins to courageously push back, like the United States, other countries follow suit. Other countries have fallen suit followed the U.S. in recognizing Jerusalem. Right? America was the first, and other countries slowly but surely are following its lead. And I believe if the United States determinedly advances this policy, other countries will follow. That is to say, this is not a consensus of conviction. It is a consensus of fear and convenience.
Yeah. So it actually can be reversed. The question is, will the United States, certainly one can't envision the Biden administration doing that, but perhaps a successor would.
I think a successor would start in a completely different place, right? A successor would start, what took a while for the Trump administration to achieve. So yes, certainly. We can definitely imagine change.
Yeah, it's not set in stone. Let's broaden our lens in terms of, you know, sort of this whole international community and the way the UN operates and the way it tries to weaponize this often bogus concepts of international law against Israel. And there's been a new round of UN activity on Israel recently. I guess the question is, many in Israel, certainly, and even some in the American Jewish community, tend to dismiss the UN as an institution of no importance, you know, shmoom, you know, the Ben-Gurion's dismissal of it. And yet, it still has an impact on the way the world thinks. How worrying is it, and how dangerous is it to Israel that the UN just continues in this vein and seems to continue to grow worse rather than better?
Yeah, the UN, by its structure, is very hard to influence and is a fertile bed of anti-Israel activism, and it gives it the legitimacy of this international organization. It's a real problem. I mean, I think shmoom is correct, but I think in the sense that Ben-Gurion meant it. Ben-Gurion didn't say that the UN has no effect or no meaning, but he says Israel needs to take care of its vital interests regardless of what the UN says. So Israel shouldn't act differently. That's for sure correct. But that doesn't mean that this is not in a problem and that it doesn't have a diplomatic effect. There's no quick solution to it. But I think generally understanding that the UN is not some august international legislature, but a talking shop composed mostly of dictators who fundamentally ignore human rights abuses, takes away from, you know, the main currency that the UN trades on is its perceived legitimacy. Right? So when people cite UN resolutions against Israel, okay, so what's it matter? It matters if you think it has, you know, some kind of moral imprimatur. But when you see, you know, that it's countries like China and Venezuela and Algeria who are, you know, baking these resolutions, then it becomes, it loses that moral shine. And there's always been an automatic anti-Israel majority at the UN. It's a convenient place for countries to sort of seek the safety in numbers and making abhorrent statements. And we have to remember the UN, you know, in 1975 voted that the very idea of a Jewish state is illegitimate. So they have since modified that somewhat, but they have not really changed their fundamental institutional stripes.
Yes, and by reviving the whole Durban process, they are basically re-ratifying Zionism as racism. In some ways, aren't they?
Yeah, the strange thing is that just as the Arab states have given up on boycotting Israel, that cause has been adopted principally in Turtle Bay, New York at UN headquarters and Brussels in the EU. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the Abraham Accords really did sort of break the logjam in terms of normalization between Israel and the Arab states, something that former Secretary of State, current climate czar John Kerry, insisted could never happen, pounded the table, said, no, it couldn't happen, yet it did. That kind of, that seemed to change the landscape. In your view, is that going to ultimately alter the way international law and the sort of the advocates of, in the NGOs and the so-called human rights community, is that going to influence them, or are they just going to continue regardless of even what Israel's former enemies say?
Yeah, no, because they never took the Arabs seriously as actors. They condescend tremendously to them. So Arab support for Israel will be seen as some kind of false contrast. They don't really care about the Arabs. So if the Arabs say this is what's good for us, they will take no interest in this, because I don't think they were ever concerned about what's good for the Arabs. This is a purely internal European monologue. Though, speaking of Secretary Kerry, it's very funny what really did come around, because in the end, Israel has normalized, has made peace, and actually burgeoning and extraordinary relations with numerous Arab states, Morocco, UAE, Bahrain. I had the pleasure of attending the beautiful National Day party hosted by the Bahraini embassy in honor of His Majesty's ascendance to the throne. It was a really lovely party, and everyone was there, and it was just totally normal, and it was totally fine. You'd think that Israel and Bahrain had been like friends forever. It was really quite nice. At the same time, Syria remains a mortal enemy of Israel, fundamentally tied to Israel's principal enemy, Iran. In 2009, shortly after President Obama took office, Secretary Kerry's diplomatic initiative, believe it or not, was pushing Israel to make peace with Syria by giving Assad the Golan Heights, saying, peace with Syria is right around the corner. This is going to be such a breakthrough. Just give up the Golan Heights. You'll have peace with Syria. Oh, you'll have peace with an Arab country. It'll be so wonderful. So in the end, obviously, if Israel had given up the Golan, and that died down after the Syrian civil war started. But these were back in the good old days when Madame Assad was on the cover of Vogue. And so Kerry got it wrong two ways. He said, you'll never have Arab relations with the Arab Gulf states if you don't make peace with the Palestinians. And of course, he was wrong in his naive conceit that donating the Golan to Syria would somehow get them to break up with Iran, as opposed to simply increasing the surface area of their state terror apparatus.
Exactly, at a time when that country was, you know, basically committing genocide and, causing, millions of refugees. Yeah.
One great thing, it seems, about international relations is that really no one gets a report card and no one is judged by the success of their prior endeavors or prophecies, because otherwise, obviously, John Kerry would have a lot to answer for.
Indeed he would. Indeed he would. One last question. In understanding the origins of the effort to use international law to attack Israel, how important is it to understand the way, certainly within the West, the use of intersection ideology, which holds that Israel is sort of part of this oppressor, white, privileged state, no different from, forces that want to create discrimination for African-Americans. How important is that for the ability of Israel's opponents to undermine its rights and its standing in the international community?
Huge. Basically, the tactic here is to translate what's happening with Israel and the Arabs into a appealing domestic narrative and fit everything into the American story. And of course, there's absolutely no, I mean, there are some similarities, but I want to say, like, there are indeed some similarities to what's happened with blacks in America. You know, I don't want to dismiss that. Just like in the 1950s and 1960s and before, there were restrictive covenants and other kinds of Jim Crow institutions that prevented blacks from buying houses in many neighborhoods. There are today efforts, like we discussed, by Peace Now and by the United States to prevent Jews from living in certain neighborhoods. That's where the resemblance starts and stops. So there is real discrimination, real racism directed against basic Jewish rights to live and worship. So I think it's important to point out that, you know, we need to understand that we're not making the case in about fundamental discrimination against Jews as forcefully as we should, right? It needs to be pointed out over and over again that what the Palestinians are asking for is a Judenrein state. What Peace Now demands is that Jews be denied basic property rights, that people be treated differently because they are Jews.
Yeah, and in the end, this is basically ratifying and giving, you know, a kosher stamp of approval to anti-Semitism.
Yeah, and ethnic cleansing by Jordan.
And ethnic cleansing. Well, Eugene Kontorovich, we want to thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. You've given us a lot of insights and a lot of important understanding of these issues. We want to thank our listeners and viewers for tuning in today. Please like, subscribe to our podcast wherever you are listening to it, on whether it's Spotify or Google, Amazon, or any of the iHeartRadio or any of the other podcast platforms, or if you're watching it on the JNS YouTube channel or eventually on JBS TV. Please like, subscribe, give us good reviews. And thank you for tuning in, and we'll see you again next week. I hope you enjoyed this week's episode brought to you by the Jewish News Syndicate, JNS.org. Visit us at JNS.org, and please follow at Amazon and Spotify, wherever you listen to podcasts.